Tonight, all about the law. More women come forward accusing movie mogul Harvey Weinstein of sexual harassment and worse. We're going to take a look at the legal fallout with our panel of attorneys. And as the NFL talks about new rules requiring players to stand for the anthem, we'll discuss whether it's legal and constitutional to stop peaceful protests. Also, a class action lawsuit filed on behalf of victims of the Las Vegas shooting. We'll explain the case and discuss whether or not it has a chance. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to RFL. I'm Richard French, a busy hour ahead. We begin, though, with Harvey Weinstein, the movie mogul. He has been fired from his own company, that after multiple women accuse him of sexual harassment and even sexual assault. Some of the accusers, the biggest stars in Hollywood. It was a Hollywood horror story, one of the biggest movie moguls allegedly pressuring women for sexual favors.
And when he showed back up, he was just in a robe and, as I've mentioned, buck naked.
The screenwriter tells ABC News she met Weinstein to talk about a script that she had written. At the time, she says she felt powerless to say anything.
It was very clear to me and stated to me that if I say anything, I'll have a slew of lawyers on my back and no one's going to believe me over the media mogul Harvey Weinstein.
The number of accusers mounting. Nearly 30 women reportedly claim they've been harassed, assaulted. A few even accuse him of rape. Among those claiming harassment by Weinstein, Oscar winners Gwyneth Paltrow, Mira Sorvino, and Angelina Jolie. Weinstein has been fired from his own company, but a spokesperson responding saying he never had non-consensual sex with any of his accusers. In another alleged encounter, first reported by The New Yorker and which ABC News verified, Weinstein is caught on tape seemingly admitting to touching an Italian model inappropriately without her consent.
Yesterday you touched my breast.
Oh, please, I'm sorry. Just come on. I'm used to that.
Are you used to that?
Yes, come in.
New York prosecutors calling the recording horrifying to listen to, but insufficient to prove crime. But this morning, Weinstein's wife of 10 years saying in a statement, her heart breaks and she has chosen to leave her husband. Now, let me pivot back to a second to the Manhattan DA's office and specifically District Attorney Cyrus Vance and the NYPD. Both are pointing fingers. The DA's office says the NYPD arranged the sting without consulting with its office and didn't give it enough info to prove a crime. Here is Cy Vance.
Our sex crimes prosecutors made a determination that this was not going to be a provable case, and so the decision was made not to go forward. In our case, we really did what I think the law obligates us to do. Focus on the evidence and the facts that we had, and then I relied on the true professionals to help guide through the decision, which is not always going to be the popular decision.
The NYPD responded with a statement that reads, in part, the detectives used well-established investigative techniques. The recorded conversation with the subject corroborates the facts that were the basis for the victim's complaint to the police a day earlier. This evidence, and here's the strong part, along with other statements and timeline information, was presented to the office of the Manhattan DA. And it should be noted there's been questions about contributions to Cy Vance's campaigns from none other than Mr. Weinstein. All right, let's bring in our legal panel to hash this out. Elizabeth Cronin is the director of the New York State Office of Victim Services. Doug Von Oist, founding partner of Carson Von Oist, focusing on corporate misconduct and selected by the Legal 500 as one of the most influential trial lawyers in the country. I can do that by heart by now. Mark Furnish, adjunct professor at the Elizabeth Haub School of Law at Pace University. He's argued before the U.S. Supreme Court. And Mayo Bartlett, a former colleague of Ms. Cronin, is an attorney at the law offices of Mayor Bartlett PLLC and a former chief of the Bias Crimes Unit at the Westchester County DA's office. Okay, a lot to unpack here, so I'm going to try and put it into two groups, criminal, then civil. You heard what the DA said. You heard what the NYPD said. We played a small portion of that recorded conversation on a wire. It makes your skin crawl when you hear the entirety of it, not that that wasn't bad enough. If he wanted to, could the DA have done more at the time with, as we understand, the evidence put in front of him?
Well, you know, it's really hard to second guess DA's decisions because they are privy to information that we're not. And I think it's something that prosecutors often lamented was that their decisions were being second-guessed. They have an extremely professional sex crimes unit there. I think very highly of them. They are techniques that are employed. We had cases in child sex abuse or teenage sex abuse cases where we used similar techniques to that of having the victim wear a wire or record a conversation with the accused. So that is not something that is outside the general purview of criminal investigation.
So in terms of criminal exposure potentially here for Mr. Weinstein, among the contributing factors that were complicated is you have statute of limitations, right? You have, in some cases, settlements. And also at this point, there is a difference between harassment and assault.
Right.
It seems, at least on the surface, it's going to be a hard case to prove if, in fact, they want to reopen it.
Well, the statute of limitations, this woman came forward in 2015, so statute of limitations for sexual abuse as a felony have not run.
How many years is it, five?
Five.
Five, okay.
And for rape in New York, there is no statute of limitations, and for certain other, like B and A felonies. But in this case, she came forward, and, you know, I have to give her a lot of credit, because as you can see from all these women, strong women, who were not able to come forward, this woman made an election at a very young age to do that, and thank goodness for that, because she really started this rolling, and her case, if they determine or change their minds, could still be brought.
Listen, this just smells really bad. I mean, this woman evidently had quite a bit of baggage based upon allegations that she had bought at least twice before in Italy that were not substantiated. Now, I don't know anything about the Italian justice system, but it's not the American justice system. Using a wire is standard investigative technique, as my colleague just pointed out. This just smells really bad. You don't just prosecute somebody on the basis of the tape. You have her testimony that's going to go before a jury and a grand jury, and they're going to find it credible or not. And there's certainly, as the clip indicated, corroboration for it in the form of the tape. And this just looks like a rich person using influence through the lawyer David Boies, who I know and sat on the same floor as, to buy off a prosecution. If this was an ordinary human being, there's going to be a case brought.
Yeah, although you can certainly point out, though, and then I want to get to the civil mail, which is this crime unit has gone after very high-profile people before. You know, this is, I mean, Linda Fairstein's been a guest on this program many times before, and that no one's going to buy him off.
Or,
you know,
regime,
people can make my, fair enough, but my point is you then get to the systemic nature of this, and there's 30 different accounts, there's Academy Award-winning actresses, you have people from all different levels of the industry, that he could have operated independently without knowledge of the firm, board members. Apparently there was an MO. Somebody from his office would take usually a 23 or 24 year old aspiring actress or filmmaker or whatever, invite him to a suite or to a private location where everyone would be cleared out of. They then would disappear as well. The next day, when there would be the subsequent complaints by someone else, they would be hushed up and told to be quiet. I got to imagine, not only does Mr. Weinstein have a huge civil case potentially in front of him, but a lot of other people attached as well to that firm.
Well, I'm not so sure about the board of directors, because they probably don't necessarily have access to all this information. But if I can just very briefly just pivot back to the criminal side of it, there are people that the Manhattan District Attorney's Office is prosecuting based on virtually no evidence at all. They just got arrested yesterday on the street. There are no witnesses, not even signed depositions yet. They're not dropping charges against any of those folks, and they're not dropping charges against someone on a questionable, you know, he said, she said date rape case where maybe the person's made false accusations in the past. Maybe they were unsubstantiated actual accusations. All I can tell you is that chances are, okay, if Liz had this case when we were in the DA's office and you had tape and you had this young lady coming forward, I think that probably before they started to charge him, they would start investigating and they'd talk to some of the other people.
Would you have done more than say there's not enough here?
Well, I mean, in my experience, under New York law, the victim's testimony is enough. And
absolutely,
it didn't used to be.
You
know, we had to change
the
law to make a victim's testimony is enough. And if you as a prosecutor feel that you believe that person, then in my view, if I believe the person and feel that we have, you know, reasonable opportunity to get a conviction, then we go ahead with it.
And how rare would it be for you to actually have the benefit of a tape in addition to everything else in your case? So, I mean, if you don't believe that person, you don't go forward. Now, in terms of the rest of this stuff, though, Richard, it's Hollywood. So everyone was surprised when you talk about Bill Cosby, but my feeling all along was that there's a culture in Hollywood. And notice that here, none of these young ladies are saying they were drugged, okay? And they didn't complain. Publicly. Right. Now, so are they making a conscious decision at that point that, you know what, I have too much riding on my career, and they shouldn't be in that position, don't get me wrong, as opposed to this young lady who maybe had a little less and said, hey, I'm not taking this. But that happens each and every day, not just in Hollywood, but anywhere where you have a disparity in positions and powers.
But I wonder if, too, it was part of the fact that she was not from here, and so she was not familiar.
He did it with a French actress before, too.
But I'm wondering if she was maybe naive and felt like, I can go to the police and,
Doug,
you know.
There will be suits brought here. And my question is, as a matter of law in civil cases, if you can prove pattern, if you could prove that this did not happen in a vacuum, and then obviously the $64,000 question, $64 million question, whatever it is who wrote the checks, okay? Because if it didn't come out of his personal kitty and the film company in any way, shape, or form paid people to be quiet, that's a whole nother mess. But what's the most important thing to prove? Because apparently this has gone on for more than 20 plus years, this type of behavior.
Well, proving the actual event is the most important thing. The way you prove it is done different ways. Usually the fact that he signed a check, that wouldn't come into evidence. There are rules about that. You don't want to discourage people from settlements. But if you can prove a pattern of some kind and you can show that that pattern is it's not a mistake in any way, it's something that he's employed.
Well, we saw what happened at Fox News, and we saw that with Roger Ailes and also Bill O'Reilly to a degree, that there was pattern, that there was culture, and then the parent company decided to be involved in settlements. But my point, though, is if each of these women that have made these allegations, that there's the same MO, that the same people, not Harvey Weinstein, are setting up meetings, they clear the room so the two people can be left alone. When the calls come in the next day, the same type of messaging is, don't say anything, it's going to make it difficult for you, or, oh, by the way, there'll be a settlement, here's the non-disclosure form, you better keep quiet. Doesn't that show that this is not a one-off?
You're really talking about multiple defendants. He becomes a defendant in the case, but also the place he works becomes a defendant. If you're trying to get to the place he works because you think that they owe money to these people, well, then you have to show a knowledge or they're involved in the event by covering it up, providing the space. But you're talking about defendants.
Knowledge would be hard to
deny. Wouldn't be so sure you're going to be seeing too many civil suits. Most of these people, or a great number of them, settled and signed releases already. And there are statute of limitations problems in civil cases that are different from those in criminal
cases.
Real
quickly, come over, Mark.
Yeah.
If I make a settlement, but I didn't know at the time when I did the settlement, listen to me, that basically this was a setup that I was one in a line of 30 people this was done to, and that you aided and abetted it. It just wasn't this guy, and he writes me a check for 50 grand. Shouldn't I now, isn't my claim now that this is different? You not only, this situation happened, but you guys created the environment for it to happen.
I don't think so. I mean, you're waiving and releasing all claims that arose from anything surrounding this incident. The waiver will be very, very broad. And let's face facts, to Mayo's point, these are not babes in the woods. They're not the most sympathetic victims in the whole world ever were.
They shouldn't be put into that position.
But to quote another movie, Casablanca, we're shocked that there's gambling in the casino here. I mean, the man is an utter pig, but the term casting couch exists for a reason.
The point where iPart Company is, and again, we were talking before the show, all of a sudden, when you got a teenage daughter, this thing starts to look a little different here.
Yeah, that's blaming the victim,
right.
too.
Right, and it's somebody in their young 20s.
I wouldn't have my teenage daughter anywhere
and you're looking somebody. Some of these were established. They had family in the business. You would never, who would prey on Gwyneth Paltrow just out of, the trouble you could get into the business. But if this opens eyes for people, and maybe this has been your world, and you should say it should, and this has been going on for a while, but if it does open eyes, how at all will the law potentially treat this differently now that we have somebody that was revered and adored by so many because of movies he puts out? Has anything changed between the high-profile people in media, the Bill Cosbys, the O'Reillys, the Ailes,
now, exactly?
The bar is so low right now.
But I think we've always put the focus on the wrong person. The focus should be on the person who we hold accountable, him. He's a predator. And listening to that tape last night over and over again, it was just shocking to me how representative it is of someone who is coercing someone into behavior.
Clearly, not the first time he did that.
Correct.
The culture and institution that allowed that to happen.
Exactly.
I've got to hit a break here. Elizabeth, though, thank you so much.
Thanks
for having
me.
Great to have you. Absolutely. Please come back.
Important subject.
Coming up next here, we'll pivot to the other story in the headlines, the NFL. They want players to stand for the anthem. Some owners, they're even threatening players if they don't. And that's opening up a whole bunch of legal questions. We'll get into that after this.